5 seconds to go.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. I told you it wouldn't take long.
This is
game three between Team Freedom and Power of Friendship in WePlay League Season 3
Reserve
Weekend
time.
Edition, if you will. It's the play-in series, if you will, between these
Radiance
teams to
band.
Decide on the replacement of Complexity,
Dyer's
who
band.
Unfortunately cannot continue. Cannot continue in this particular season we play due to scheduling issues. So hey, one of these teams will make it through. It's 1-1 in the series. Whoever wins this next match will be the one who gets the chance
to
play even more games. Yay. My name is Dragon Drop, being in this match alongside Lookout up on stats and Denali getting up early down there in Australia to help me out. How
Reserve
are you doing?
Time.
You're still feeling hyped?
Pretty good. I'm feeling hyped. At this rate, I might have to go to sleep at lunchtime, but it's okay. I'm ready for this. I have tea. It's fine. But we've had some pretty good Dota so far.
Yeah.
So,
it's all you can really ask for, right? I mean, deep is overrated if you have good Dota to pass the time with, in my opinion, anyway. So, yeah, Power Friendship. We had a pretty good early game one. Game two, not so much here. They kind of caught off guard, letting the game go a little bit too long up against the Emrysburg as well as the Aberon. Mike, so they ban that out alongside the Enchantress, Team Freedom, ban out the Lone Druid, and now wondering a bit more about the secondary ban. Maybe thinking about the Invoker or something like that. Or just Nightstalker instead. So that's
Radiant
also
pick.
One of the heroes that was in the game number one
Dyer's
on
pick.
Power Friendship as well, right? Yeah, it was way too playing that.
They did. But it let the Faceless Void through. And obviously, Power Dyer's Friendship,
pick.
They see it, they take it, and there's nothing wrong with grabbing a Faceless Void. Actually, the great thing about Faceless Void is he does pretty decently up against a lot of the popular spellcasters that we have nowadays. Okay,
Radiant pick.
Pulling out the Omni Knight card. you said this is an IX Mike hero, so we'll take you for your word here.
I do imagine that to be an IX Mike hero, running it in the offlane, that kind of cool. Being super annoying, running people down, that fits right down his alley. Same for the Faceless Void, it's also in his repertoire, but Power Friendship picking that up first. Very much control on the Void. I've seen him come back, and we have seen teams experimenting with him
Five
a little
seconds.
Bit more these days, just trying to fit him back in this offlane role, and I've always been a bit reserved about it, because I feel like if you don't have the best team around it, and Faceless Void doesn't get enough a lot of farm, then he's just turning into the ultimate monkey. And that can just be a detriment to your team. Razor, one of
the
that
case
that,
with him.
Razor, though, is one of the heroes that can work outside of the current sphere quite nicely, if you manage to place it correctly. Like, if you have Aesthetic Link going, then you can't catch him in the current sphere, but Razor is still close enough for the right clicks that should be an easy kill.
Yeah, so there's nothing wrong with the Razor pickup. So we've got some very solid heroes coming up from both sides, though. But OD again for Team Freedom. Now, how does OD fare against a Razor in the mid lane scenario? Has anything really changed in that matchup?
5 seconds.
Not really. Razor's considered to be one of the better counters to OD.
Radiant's ban.
Just still because of that, that Astral Imprisonment and the interaction with the Static Link. Helping out there, so yeah, it's solid enough if you don't count any sort of rotations. And so we have yet to see some heroes being picked up, so
go.
Actually, a Bane that I haven't seen played in quite a while,
Five
funnily
seconds.
Enough. So that could tip the balance one way or the other if you wanted to go for that. Similar kind of story for Earthshakers or Bounty Hunters, but maybe they're not that popular in the American scene.
So our second phases of bans, you have a Mirana ban and a Kunkka ban from Power of Friendship. We haven't seen any Kunkka, but in this SEA region, I've seen a lot of support Kunkka coming through, and it's been run with a lot of success down there. I'm not too sure with NA. Has it been the same up here as well?
I couldn't tell you. Tell you honestly.
No?
I haven't seen it in a while.
Reserve time.
So it might just be a region thing for now. Maybe they do play in NA, we just don't know.
I guess you
Kunkka
would have
been
earlier.
A great hero.
EG played in MDL earlier, didn't they?
I didn't see most of... I don't see a lot of EG games during MDL. I followed a lot of Team Spirit games, so I don't know if they played it at all.
I just seem to remember them playing it in the first game against LGD today. I might be wrong. Okay. It's still a niche hero, that's for sure. Not gonna see him either way in this. That's been banned now. So, still plenty of options. We still have Oracle, Dazzle, these kind of defense fears on the field. Vengeful Spirit hasn't been banned out. Haven't seen any Tusk or Spirit Breaker here whatsoever.
Dire.
Just
I'm surprised about the lack of Tusk, yeah. I'm surprised about the lack of Tusk. The hero's still good in what he does. Like, nothing has changed in the style of Tusk. I'm rather curious, is it the meta that sort of shifted the hero out of the usual picks that we normally see? Still a great hero. It's up to the players. Maybe they're sick of playing Tusk. It's like, okay, I'm sick of playing this hero. Can we pick something else? Because we did see a lot of Tusk in the previous meta.
Tusk just too easy to win. Too easy to win with this hero. I can't pick him anymore.
Reserve.
Just handicap yourself to show the world you have skill. Who knows? But so Witch Doctor was the final ban for Team Freedom. A lot of support hate for Team Freedom, it seems, wanting to get rid of some of those heroes that help out during the laning phase, and down to 5 seconds reserve time for their third pickup. Pick up the Oracle. So we have a lot of healing and defensive mechanisms on the side of Team Freedom. You have not only the False Promise, but now you have the Repel as that free BKB.
That is actually a big deal if you think about the OD. I mean, we talked about it in the first game, I believe. Yes. We're talking about, right, the OD just wants a right click. And he, outside of the Astral Imprisonment, he doesn't actually have all that many defensive capabilities. If you just run at him, you should still be able to bring him down. But if there's an Omni Knight and an Oracle behind him, that gets much, 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 much harder. Even if you have a Faceless Void, if the Chronosphere isn't placed correctly, even then it's still a rather long cooldown, unless you want to go for an Aghanim Scepter build up. Yeah, Power of Friendship, they might have a really hard time dealing with Team Freedom just because of these defensive supports. Or Omni Knights, I'm saying such... support, but he might be in a 3 position.
Who knows? But yeah, I agree with you 100%. And because they picked up heroes like this, I would honestly like to see Team Freedom picking up another hero which suffers a similar situation to OD, where obviously if you want to go ham, he just doesn't have the sustain. Obviously if you have only an Oracle, they can help you with that. Are there any heroes that are sort of sticking out for you that Team Freedom could potentially pick up with that can fight with the help of Omni Knight and Oracle?
So it could go for the Ember Spirit again, honestly. But other options would be maybe Bristleback, Ursa, these kind of heroes that...
In-your-face heroes.
Exactly, these interface heroes that can get kited a little bit, but if you give them the space, if you give them the backup with the heals and the slows as well, and the lockdown from Oracle and Omni Knight, they can function much, much better. It's because also they have more time to run around the fight.
5 seconds.
Yeah, wouldn't be too surprised to see something like that coming.
Reserved.
We had a third pick, Undying from the Power of Friendship. So I presume this is going to be a support Undying. In this game, how effective do you think the Undying is going to be? There's a lot of sustain on Team Freedom, and I don't think the Undying is going to perform like he usually would.
It's curious. I mean, they still have the option to go for a pretty good aggressive trial lane, either around the Faceless Void or just for two extra heroes that they pick up now. And Dying fits into that, just making sure that you, from the first minute on, essentially, just put on the pressure on whatever safe lane Team Freedom want to pick up. And as good as Oracle is, he needs his levels to start providing that help. Similar kind of story for Omni Knight. So, yeah. Look, it seems to me that Power Friendship just wants to take medicine to their own hands early. Make sure that you have that Tombstone available, have that Decay to put things in your favor in these early teamfights.
But we have a Queen of Pain fourth pickup for Team Freedom. So they've got another source of damage output. Very fragile hero. Obviously, you're going to have Omni Knight and Oracle to back her up as well. Disruptor fourth pick for Power of Friendship. Now, this is going to be a major hero for them, especially when it comes to chasing, because Glimpse, such a great spell. Keep in mind, though, I'm pretty sure if you repel the hero, you will not get Glimpsed.
Yeah. Repel acts like a BKB in that sense. That's something that we haven't seen in game one, because Omni Knight has been banned out, I think. But
yes,
you still have to keep in mind the interaction between the Astral Imprisonment Reserve from the OD. Which is something that I've learned today, so the more you know, right? So where you You can ask for yourself when you feel glimpse, but you're still gonna end up at the glimpse location after the imprisonment ends, which is very interesting. I mean, I believe Zombie was playing that in game one, and he's been able to blink out more than once after the fact, but
10 seconds to go.
Sometimes he just wasn't because Static Storm was in there doing the instant damage. So.
5 seconds.
That Disruptor, definitely good against this, up against the Queen of Pain too, obviously. The Quab is
a
blinking
draft,
in, you drop
honestly.
Down. Yeah. The thing is, it doesn't really, it just kind of takes the aggressive tri-lane potential out of the picture. Because that's not exactly a strong laning. So,
yeah,
I'm thinking
absolutely.
Actually dual lanes, Undying Chris is
void.
Depending on what kind of safe lane they pick up, if it's someone like a Spectre again, then Undying might just have to stick around in the bottom lane, just find help out there too. That's someone like a Gyrocopter or anyone else that can take care of of himself. Just with a little bit of help from Disruptor, then Undying is freed up to help out Faces Void up top.
Gyrocopter's looking attractive here for Power Friendship. I would like to see Gyro for Power Friendship, just to round out the draft. Also works with the Faceless Void with the cooldown. Like, you get the full damage from cooldown, Rocket Barrage. If you're close enough, remember? If you're not close enough, obviously not going to hit the target, but yeah. I would like to see Gyrocopter here for Power Friendship. Team Freedom, Zeus last pick. So this is probably going to be that core Omni Knight that you were talking about.
Yeah.
Unless
maybe.
It's an offlane Zeus, which I don't really like.
No.
I think it's Omni Knight.
It should be Oracle Zeus support. Not exactly the most common support to Zeus, but of course it crops up every once in a while. And last game around, Kiko wasn't really bad at it. He was able to find a lot of farm. Was able to ride a lot of extra burst damage out of that position. And
10 seconds to go.
It does have some merit in the early lane phase if you don't have to be in a position where you just have to try and defend your carry. But when you are in a position to put on damage yourself, put on aggression yourself, and that's a Spectre pick that didn't quite expect that. Just because of what we were just talking about. There's not a lot of synergy with Faces Void. Very weak lane once again up against an Omni Knight Zeus potential offlane. I don't know, I don't really like this lineup for Power Friendship, to be honest.
Yeah. The major thing, as you said before, was like there's no synergy between Spectre and Faceless Void up until Spectre gets the Radiance. Then at least she can still do Radiance Burn. But outside of that, yeah, it doesn't really work for me.
Maybe
we'll see
just,
if it works up a Power Friendship.
I guess a Power Friendship can keep the game going. They're going to have three cores to go into the late game and a Disruptor who can be pretty good at just locking these heroes down. Even when it comes to later parts of the game, when he builds an Agnum Scepter, so any sort of BKB is ineffective too. So if they can drag out the game long enough, then they should be able to take it just in terms of the carry potential, but I'm not sure it's going to get to that point because you're going to have an Oracle. You're going to have an Oracle supporting everyone on the entire map, stabilizing the lanes. You're going to have an Outworld Devourer who will do a ridiculous amount of damage. Going to have a Queen of Pain with some bursts in her own right, plus the Zeus support once again, so... Freedom, they have the tools to just put under pressure on PoF before they can get to the point where they can just outscale. Okay, we'll find out what's going on in this game number 3 in a best of 3 series, the final match to decide who will replace Complexity in WePlay League Season 3. My name is Dragonjob, I'm joined by Danley on the co-casting chair, and if you see a little box here with some interesting numbers and stats and facts on the right hand side. That's the doing of Lurkerdub, who is joining us in a stats capacity, you could say. Yeah. So the teams, let's take a quick look as Mineski Fange, once again, picking up the Queen of Pain for the mid position perhaps this time around. That kind of build, Kiko on the support Zeus once again, and the offlane is going to be IX Mike on the Omni Knight, Zombie on the OD. And I'm just switching it around again. We'll see. It's fun on the Oracle, reprising his role from game number 1.
So on the side of POF, that's going to be on the Radiant squad for today. We have MJW on the Faceless Void, who is looking at the Bounty Rune, but he's definitely not going to be going into there. It'll be a little suicide mission if he does. We have Way 2 on the Undying, moving in towards that middle lane. Down towards the bottom, we've got Popeye on our Razor. Sneaking, handling the Spectre for the second time of the day, and finally we've got our Disruptor being played up by Mario. So both mids securing their runes. Nothing out of the ordinary this game.
Yep. No early aggressions. The lanes will take shape. It looks like, yeah, it is going to be the Queen of Pain, just to not have that disadvantageous matchup with the Outworld Devourer. It's something that we haven't talked about, but it does make a lot of sense in my book. Queen of Pain, yeah. Much more even matchup with the Razor.
Yeah, she's going to have an easier time harassing out the Razor. Static Link won't really be that much of a factor once she gets that point into Blink. Like, once you have Blink, you just Blink out of it. So it's not really going to be that great for Popeye to consistently Static Link the Queen of Pain. Like, if you force out a Blink, that's fine. Just use a little bit of mana. But, yeah, mid lane looks like it's going to be standard. Dual lanes for Freedom. We'll see if this works out. Zeus Omni-Knight against a tri-lane against PoF. What are your thoughts on this?
Some interesting lanes here. I mean, they're doing exactly what we're talking about. Omni-Knight plus one, in this case is Zeus. That's can be a scary tri-lane, just leave this back to Disruptor there. So Weitu is being forced to stick around here to help zone him out. Which does mean that MJW on the Faceless Void in the offlane is not going to have a good time, right? He can't get close to wave or else just the right-click down by Sunbee. He shouldn't die just because of the time walk, but shouldn't get too much either. Yeah. I'm looking at this bottom lane to be the side of the first blood here, the way this has been going so far.
I'm curious, will PoF be able to get first blood? If they can, it'll be a huge win bottom lane scenario.
Only Freedom is going too far. Right, Kiko and Ike Mike, they still need a couple of levels, they're still both just level 1. And that's why PoF is doing a really good job, just slowing them away from experience, making sure that they don't get the combat effectiveness up and running. Because you need to repel as well as the purification, you ideally need the arc lightning on top of the static field just to be able to outdamage them. Up against the Undying, it's so hard, because look at him. He just has 3 decay stacks going constantly. 4 health points on the Omni-Knight means that he just can't stay close. At this point, Disruptor's gonna have level 2 soon, the Glimpse back will be real at that point. And Snaking can also come in and try and snag the kill if there's so few health points to play with.
And considering how the lane is going so far for Freedom, would you say that maybe Kiko should just rotate out of lane? Just because, like, they're being completely pushed out of lane, they don't want to go too deep, although they're gonna move a little bit further into the lane, but you don't want to die. And because of the lack of EXP, it's Kiko and IX Mike sharing the EXP. Maybe Zeus moves out of the lane and lets IX Mike get a couple of levels before he maybe returns to help out.
Where do you go though? I mean, I think the Zeus threat just for
you can stack
extra
the jungle.
Bit of damage. Yeah, but I think the Zeus threat with the extra bit of damage is make sure that Mike can get at least something in terms of levels. Otherwise, I mean, you see Weitu and Mario, they don't leave this lane, they don't leave this camp. I mean, they're farming it up a little bit, but they're always ready to just zone out and secure the lane for sneaking. So, yeah, apart from stacking camps, there's not much else that Zeus could do. Top lane, you're not going to get a kill in MJW no matter how many heroes you would throw up there, because you just don't have the control to keep him from time walking. Middle lane as well, Razor is not exactly an easy hero to gank with 1 point up into your stable current, but it's more than enough to help you up against the Zeus.
We'll see what Freedom wants to do with the Zeus. Meanwhile though, look at this top lane. Like MJW, he's got 100% control in this top lane. You would not expect this from a Faceless Void to do this well up against Sunbee.
Yeah.
He's technically free farming, and this is not a scenario that you want to be in if you're Freedom. Because if a Faceless Void is farming and he gets a very early 6, he can potentially solo kill Sunbee.
Shouldn't actually happen. I would have expected Sunbee to just right-click him down every single time, prisoner him up every once in a while. Let's get some extra
Quick
nice,
is focusing on
the...
He's focusing on CSing. It seems like he doesn't want to harass MJW.
He's actually out-leveling him too. Level 5 as opposed to almost level 5 on OD. Of course, that's Oracle being there for a while, but now... On this rotating mid, he has level 3, so has the Ultra Zen plus a little bit of extra nuke. He'd be looking at the Razor, but this time would be better spent up top, just helping zone as MJW.
Yeah,
That's
they have to deal with him. They can't leave him alone. Like, this guy is... he's happy. If you're MJW, you're just smiling while you're playing. All this gold! But I expect him to probably just go for the standard faceless
mid lane
build. Oh.
I don't know, way too okay, they just high-five each other, I guess.
Just face 5, it's fine.
Top lane? I'm okay. Very aggressive here with Sunbee.
Yeah.
Plenty of health points to play with. He still has a fairy fire to fall back on.
Halfway to six, though. This faceless void is a ticking time bomb. And he knows it. Like, he's just gonna slowly harass Sunbeam down.
See what you did there? I see what you did.
I don't actually intend
yes,
for it to happen.
Yes, of course.
No,
tell it
I'm,
to the judge,
Stanley.
Tell it to the judge.
I am serious.
Tell it to the pun police. God. Don't fool me. Oh, yeah, that was a quote of memes for today. Have to be careful not to meme cast too much, of course. But
I didn't intend to. I legitimately didn't intend to do
just,
it.
Just relax.
It just happened.
Just relax. I'm just messing with you.
Oh my god.
Oh, Minesky Fange. Oh. Yeah, he wanted to have the rune. Arcade rune too, super useful for Kuna Pain, but was being very low in health, and the two heroes on POF securing that makes sure that Kuna Pain is forced back to base, but at the very least, I'll give Kiko a little bit of space here in this mid lane. Get some levels of his own.
Lanes are looking so good for POF. They haven't lost anybody as of yet. Even though they're not getting kills, they're winning their lanes so convincingly. Like, the two supports pressuring the early portion of that bottom lane to make sure IX Mike wasn't really that farmed. We do have Minesky Fange coming down with the Sonic Wave.
That was level 6.
Three heroes. They're gonna go for an easy kill.
Should be getting it too. Sneaking caught with the Sonic Wave as well, but there's a Tombstone coming out. They might actually get the counter kill. The Queen of Pain, yeah, it doesn't enough matter, but bites the ball up in between, nice little jukes across the tree line, there's the heal from IX Mike,
sneaking.
But he uses for a screen page. I get the kill on the sneaking instead of blink out. Definitely the right decision, and now they're gonna turn around on Tombstone. Didn't quite do enough, even though it's level 2, so not a bad Tombstone. Just any case, but also it's a little bit more than they bargained for with the help from Omni Knight turning it around here.
And I like what they did though. With this, like, just because they knew that the Zeus was struggling, rotating Queen of Pain down the bottom lane, Kiko's now in the mid lane, soaking up EXP. So efficient use of lanes whilst getting those kills for Freedom. Like, Freedom are playing this game 100%. Not to say that POF isn't either, but just great decision making overall. I'm expecting the same from POF, honestly, with any sort of rotations. Just give it to the support so that they can hit that level 6 with a pretty good timing.
Fange now taking back over the middle lane, but Razor also had pretty much free farm here as a result. Zeus, of course, soaking up experience, but only being level 4 as opposed to level 8. Not exactly able to put on pressure on the Razor, so it's only a matter of time until Popeye comes into play. That'll... is he gonna go for the mech build here? I mean, seems like a good option if they want to start fighting with the Void, Chrono, as well as the Spectre Haunt. Just both online now.
He can go for the mechanism, but it will limit his offensive capabilities, and I don't know if he can actually get away with the mechanism first this game. It just feels like he might have to go for Sand and Yasha first to have that initial burst of damage, and then maybe he can go back for the mechanism just for the extra sustain. Because if you take a look at their draft, if they pop a Chrono now, what is their damage output outside of the Razor right clicks? Disruptor doesn't really hit hard. You can maybe get lucky with the Undying with a couple of stacks of the zombies and a soul rip, and obviously Decay is going to come in useful, but their damage output isn't impressive. So someone has to start the momentum with damage, and it looks like it might have to be Popeye. Like, even though Spectre can come in with Haunt, Spectre's not an alpha in himself.
I have to rely on Razor being able to get off long duration static link, but he hasn't really been leveling that up, so even if I have that going for a couple of seconds, it's not really going to pump you up as much as you maybe need if you catch up a tanky target. That being said though, there's not a whole lot of tanky people inside of Freedom, outside of IX Mike perhaps, and Minesky Fang can get some blink out. MGW can follow him with a timer Chrono if he wanted to, but yeah, as you said, where's the damage going to come from? At the same time, there's plenty of help in the lane. IX Mike still sticking around, level 6 now. Actually go for points into the Guardian Angel though.
Probably not expecting any fights early on. But he probably realizes this the scenario for POF as well, so it's like, yep.
Top lane, sneaking. He's here, there's unfortunately then locking down, there's the Minesky Fange just blowing him up. Way too unable to do anything, and now he gets nuked down after dropping down a tombstone. That was an assassination. Like in the
mission successful.
Yeah. Like in a textbook. Textbook Dota there.
Textbook. That's the second time that they've lost the Spectre as well. So not only did the Spectre have a bit of a funky time down bottom, but now he dies up top too. That's not a scenario that you want to be in if you're a Spectre. But looks like the Razor gonna try and chase down the Queen of Pain, who has no blink for 3 seconds. Can Mineski Fangin get out of time? No, he dies. Slain by the Electrical Knight.
There's a Haunt coming in as well, though. Armed Kiko looking to bring him down with a wraparound. The Chronosphere even onto Fun. And now Razor on the outside, slapping away.
My goodness.
Oh, they turn one kill into three. Beautiful usage of the ultimate. Yeah, exactly what we were talking about that they wanted to do, right? To use the Chrono perfectly, making sure that Razor can right click, making sure that Spectre can still make use of the Haunt before that or after that. Toughened up their structures. Once again, PoF shows us that they know how to play their draft, right? And this is a very useful capability they have. Same time top lane. Well, Francis, Queen of Pain doesn't have that big ult. Can't really burst down the way too, and now
the nice deny.
Oh, look at the damage though. Assassin to try and TP out, will he be able to make it? Yeah.
Sonic Wave and he would have been dead. Oh, Snaking.
Another Scream of Pain would have been enough.
Yeah. It was on cooldown for 2 seconds, though. It was very, very close. Tower could use a little help. But, Snaking, trying to be... Mineski has his Sonic Wave in 30 seconds, so if Snaking actually sticks around for that little bit more, he could get bursted down by the Queen of Pain, but it looks like he will be leaving lane. Overall, though, if we take a look at the net worth of everybody, we have the Razor on top, he's sitting on a lot of gold, who has bought something. It is the drums. Well, it looks like PoF love their drums, as we saw them pick up 3 in the first game of the Best of 3 series, and it looks like poor Mario just gets slain, even just giving the OD a bit of a trip back into the jungle, saying, okay, I'm gonna send you back a little bit after the kill, it's fine, dude. Free taxi ride.
Yeah, they're just courteous, right? I mean, alright, you made a good play, you called me out, just have a free trip back, why not? Not really fitting to any Dota, but hey.
They might intercept Popeye here. If he actually went through the river a little bit more, he would have been intercepted. He could have been in a lot of trouble, but he did back out in time.
Wise decision, that's for sure. Might still be in trouble. Could Kiko on the back, Sunbe able to set up with us with an Astral Imprisonment if he can get in range, but at the same time, PoF didn't know that this could be an opening for themselves, so even trying to turn around with the smoke. MGW lead charge, he does have a Chronosphere.
Interestingly enough, Mineski Fangaze going for an Orchid.
Kiko's actually.
What are your thoughts on Mineski going for this Orchid? Is it mainly going to be for the Faceless Boy to prevent him from getting those Chronos? Mid lane, we just see poor Kiko getting slain, by the way. But the Orchid on the Queen of Pain, like, who's the main target for this outside of MJW?
It's a good question.
Could it also be the Disruptor?
The Disruptor
will be here. Yeah.
Actually, anyone who hasn't used the spell yet, really. Because if you think about it, if you silence up the MJW when you got the Chrono off, doesn't really matter. If you silence up Way 2 when you got the Tombstone off, doesn't matter. If you silence up Disruptor when you got the Static Storm off, doesn't matter whatsoever. Same kind of story for Razor with the Static Link as well as his Ultimate. So, Spectre 2, right? Spectre doesn't really do much with spells.
It will amplify the Queen of Pain damage.
I ended up dying here, and Skvenge comes in with a blink and a slow. A little bit extra burst damage though, they have it with the Queen of Pain ultimate. They do get the Fortune Zen channel a little bit. Yeah, they have to commit it to on top of the purification, so that's a lot of pure damage coming in at once. The rest of PF unable to rotate in time.
They might be able to cut them off if they don't TP. Oh, never mind, they're not gonna bother.
Oh, he comes right back in. And now MJW, perfect Chrono opportunity here. Popeye on the back. They should be able to bring down the Queen of Pain in the beautiful transition into the Static Storm. Fun and Ice Mike both down for the count. Actually gets another purification off. Has to repel. Has to count an angel. Just TP's out. They can't do anything.
There's no magical damage.
You had repel too, so. Alright, Sneaky comes in. Kiko, he will be the count. He will retreat instead, so hey. It'd be the consolation prize, exactly. Yeah, that must be super frustrating, right? Repel and Guardian Angel? You have no spell left to actually stop the TP, so. Even if you did, you had to go through BKB, so hey, it's can't do anything, it's so ridiculous.
I would have expected a lot of, like, protruding veins from their foreheads, thinking, what is this?
What's wrong,
that hurts, though. It just goes to show, though, like, if it's gonna be able to keep IX Mike alive like
Disruptor, hang on.
What, Oh, Jesus. But consider though, you have to consider, Guardian Angel, if it does that to keep IX Mike alive during the fights, what happens if he gets that off in a 5-on-5 team fight? What's PoF really going to do? Because you look at their entire draft, they don't really have the best magical burst lane, to get through Guardian Angel.
Hold that thought. Oh. Almost dies to the hammer, but Sunbeam now has to try and TP out after the Prisma unsnaking. As a player, just trying to go for the play, but recognizing when the right time is to pull out, so not giving a kill over to sneaking, which, I mean, he had a good laning stage, but since then they've done a pretty good job at actually locking him down. Radiant's 1-3-3, a decent amount of timing on the phase drums, but now once again, it's Kvenge. If he had his ultimate, might have been another kill, but
middle lane.
Middle lane, what is going on here? False Promise not keeping the Oracle alive now. Glimpse back onto IX Mike. Didn't repel himself, was on cooldown. There's an Aspen Prisma to keep him alive, but no Chronosphere for another 30 seconds. And there's the blink out. Here's a blink, by the way. Hey, there's the Sonic Wave. Will barely land on Razor here. Another blink in for both the Queen of Pain and the OD, who's now continuing to right click here way too. Will be right click down, another blink, another nuke. Now they're just on the run. They just keep tracking them down though. Double kill for Sunday. Extra kill for the Queen of Pain. Yeah, that looked like a really, really good initiation there from POF. With the glimpse back onto IX Mike without the repel going, but that was a well timed Astral Imprisonment there from Sunday. Turn that around entirely. I'm just gonna go for Roche.
Now, Orchid is down on the Queen of Pain as well, so obviously with this up, he is gonna make the most of it. It's gonna be a bit of a surprise factor here for Snake King, so here we go. Orchid is there, straight TP. Do they have the burst? No Sonic Wave. Rather unfortunate, so. For Snake King, just to go straight for the TP is the right play. He probably didn't expect the Orchid to. Actually, he probably may have expected it to be already up. That may have been why he just went for the straight TP. But Haunt is there.
Oh, Haunt, they want to fight this here. Yeah, there's the Chronosphere on two heroes. Meanwhile, Kiko will be tracked down by Snake King. Do they have enough damage? The Guardian Angel came out from IX Mike. MGW will still get the kill, but Sunbeam gaving them down regardless. That's the repel. And has the Aegis, but there's no support rotating in. But he gets the blink out. Nothing there to cancel. No, if there was a Radiance on Spectre at this point, or if Disruptor was there with the Static Storm, they would have gotten the secondary kill, but as it stands, Freedom doing a good job limiting the casualties there, but good move in there from PF, recognizing that they can make something happen here. Now it's going to take a tier 1 tower as an extra consolation.
They need
price.
It.
Yeah, absolutely.
They really need it. They need the gold so badly. But Razor,
will get the gold, but at what cost is the TP and 2 TPs actually? Double Static Storm, Fun will get brought down immediately. Axe Mike completes the TP, you have to repel on top of him, and now Razor starts wrecking some damage. Sunby tries to chase him out, snaking. Trying to do what he can, but let's go for the glimpse back. TP out, perhaps, did nothing to stop it. Yeah. Once again, nicely played from PF, recognizing that can't really take a full on team fight with Sunby just chasing it down like that. Without the Chronosphere.
It's good. It's good though. They got the T1 and they also get an Oracle kill on top of that. So just more on top of more for POF's pile of gold. What's the progression on the Spectre so far? It's about 18 minutes in. He has, what is this being delivered? It is a Yasha. So he's going for cost efficient stats this game. So Snake King recognizing that he can't really afford to pull up the gold. So he's just going to go for those that heavy items to help him out a little bit, and the extra movement speed will help him out when it comes to moving through camps as well as maneuvering around. So it's not that bad that Spectre's going for this. It's just he realizes he can't go for the Radiance first. So Mantis Star's fine. Gets rid of the Orchid too.
I actually don't think that Radiance would be the best way to go in this game anyway, because you have an Omni Knight on the other team, right? So someone will have to go to Fusil Blade. Might as well be the Spectre who can. Oh, well, he's being wrapped around him. Mario's there, but there's the blink, there's the silence. And then this Sonic Wave, but it's not gonna be enough room for him to go out anyway. Same for the Disruptor, he will just be right click down. Everyone else on the run, they do have a Chronosphere. But where's the damage? Once again, they need Popeye in a good position. Up against 5, just not gonna have the time, funnily enough, to bring them all down. Kiko is deeping out, they find him, but he gets out of time.
That's unfortunate. That's also the Razor Radiant ultimate too. Like, even though the cooldown for it's not that bad, he's not gonna be able to really do too much in the top lane. You're gonna try and go in? T2 will stand. They're going to keep on chasing. Unfortunately, Disruptor's not in a position to get a good glimpse off. He's just too far away unless they find Freedom Glimpse. Oh.
Just barely not in range.
Yep. If they got the glimpse, then at least getting that kill would have been beneficial for POF. But at least they didn't lose the T2 tower.
Freedom still respecting the Chronosphere and the Razor, who is actually the highest farmer on POF. Pretty much tied with the Queen of Pain, and even Sunday on the Apple Devourer is not terribly far ahead. So if you look at the graphs now, it's 3k in favor of Freedom. 20 minutes in, that's not insurmountable by any means. POF still have the late game if you want to remember that. I want to mine the
top tower. Do they really have the late game though? Because I've seen scenarios where teams pick up Spectres hoping that, you know, Spectre's gonna be big enough to be that late game insurance, but then the Spectre just comes online to a point where it's just too late.
Yeah, when I talk about late game like that, I mean just where everyone has their core items, right? Ultra late game.
Ah, okay. So if that's the case in that, yeah. Like, Snake King's trying to find as much farm on the map as he can, but he's just under so much pressure because he always worries about the Queen of Pain blinking on top of him with the Orchid. And without the Manta style, Snake King can't leave the map comfortably. Trouble brewing. So, like, that's why he's just farming in, you know, he's not farming efficiently because it's not that he doesn't want to, it's because he can't. So, and if you take a look at Kiko, he's looking around the enemy jungle, seeing if he can spot Snake King. They will see him in the mid lane, and you take a look at this, like, take a look at everyone on the side of Freedom. They just make a beeline for that mid lane, and Snake King's like, okay, I showed myself, I better just get out of here. I can't stay. I'm not welcome.
Turns into a standard T2 for T2 tower trade. Dire's top tower. Nothing really happening. Both teams taking a bit of a breather, perhaps. Right now. Trying to get the next core items up for POF.
Casual Cloak. Radiant's mid tower could use a hand. Casual Cloak and the Spectre. Just trying to survive at this point.
Don't hate it, to be honest.
No, I won't blame him. Like, he just wants to survive. Because he's gone for Dispersion, too.
So, let's take a look at another look at items. Razor has something else, 2.5k in the bank. Is he looking for the BKB now? Just to... Yeah. I guess that would be the play for everyone, right? At some point or another.
Yeah. Just go BKB.
Void is also working on the MGW with the Yoga Club. Ready in inventory and... Undying, actually? Working on that Aghanim Scepter, more than halfway there. What do you think about that item? Is it too good, or is it just... kinda nice to have?
It's nice to have. Like, it's still expensive. If you think about it, like 4.2k gold, but the great thing is that you're stealing so much strength, so you end up going to be having this secondary frontline tank. It doesn't solve the problem that POF is still lacking a lot of damage. Like, way too probably going to die.
They place the wall, they still see him though, there's the blink, and yeah, they're just going right down after the Scythe. Well,
yeah.
Speaking of Scythe, 32% match is actually only built on a day. 74% win rate.
This is assuming he's ahead, because there's an AD, it's hard enough to farm the gold.
That's OD in a nutshell, though, right? And we talked about it before, it's not a catch up here. It's here that if he's ahead, he can carry you all the way through. Yeah.
Yeah. Like Ricky or Clinks, just heroes that farm heroes to get their gold.
All items, Zeus. Looks like he wants to go for the fail once again after the Aether lens. Kind of standard build. Top lane. Ah, zombie. Able to get the Taxon Prisman off. In Orchid, we saw an effective. We talked about that. Anything else? Not really on the way. Ike's Mike is a gem, so that's useful. He's also building into an Aghanim Scepter of his own, by the looks of it.
I'm rather curious with the smoke from POF because they're bringing three heroes that are
here. Chronosphere,
you have
two heroes here! Spectre Haunt comes in here, but on top of
but
the.
Comes in
just at the edge. IX Mike will end up dying, but Mineski, he gets the BKB off, got the Sonic Wave, which is just not enough damage. He doesn't need to blink out once again, but the right things are there in time. Fun tried to help out, but didn't actually get the False Promise off for some reason. Now just gets glimpsed back, or his Death Corpse. Dead Corpse gets glimpsed back, and now they're looking for more. They find Kiko. the other side of the trees, but I'm not quite fast enough to finish them off. Or are they? Do they want to dive? They do want to dive the freaking tier 3s. Why then not another right click would have done it, but with a TP in from OD. Now, with the turnaround onto MJW. And yeah, Kiku actually claims the counter kill himself. Out of spite, by the looks of it.
And looks like PoF not able to secure a tower on top of this too. It honestly looked like it was going to be a little bit scary for PoF when they got the chrono down, but they had enough damage to kill IX Mike. He was he's relatively tanky if you take a look at IX Mike, but they dropped him quick enough. He wasn't able to get the spells off. And then obviously Queen of Pain was easy pickings after that, after she used the blink as well as the BKB. So great stuff from PoF. I honestly underestimate the damage output coming out from PoF now. I felt like they were doing a little bit less than that, but yeah, they are starting to show that they are starting to accumulate some of that damage, which Freedom is going to have to show a little bit of respect to. And it seems like they do realize PoF might be getting a little bit out of control, so they're going to go for their own smoke to shut someone down. If they could get PoF Eye, that would be huge.
They find
but instead,
Mario.
They just get
the
Disruptor. So if they got PoF Eye, though, could have been better.
Oh, fun. What is he doing? Where are you going?
Oh my goodness.
Gotta have to force promise himself. Maybe it was a bait. Somebody comes in under the cover of Repel. That was almost really bad though.
It would have been a nice bait if they had Hex. Yeah. It would have been a good bait if they had the Hex, and they would have gotten the guaranteed kill. But without it, it's almost impossible. So it could have been a very good unintentional play.
I want to talk about PoF Team Fight again. That was once again the combo, right? Chronosphere into Disruptor Static Storm, into the Spectre Horn just coming in from wherever she is. Problem with that is, that's your ultimates. All your ultimates committed to that.
Committed.
So after that, there's a while where Freedom have a really good option of just, or a really good timing window, just going for a place like that themselves. In this case, as you said, they only get Mario. They commit the hacks just to make sure that they get it swiftly. There's no sort of return potential, but if Freedom can keep taking advantage of these ultless times from PoF, then they should be able to keep up at the very least. Look at net worth, they're still ahead, I guess, 3k in terms of golden experience, but still. Just in terms of momentum in teamfights, it feels like PoF have the better teamfights straight up, if they get the spells up first, obviously.
Obviously, baiting out ultimates would also be great, but you're going to put yourself at risk to do so. So if they can get anything like that if they can get any of those ultimates baited out.
Spectre
Horn
sees everyone on the back to try and screen for a Roche, not to engage or anything. Let's once again run these cooldowns out. We'll respawn in a moment's time, but Freedom will be back in position to start a fight. And yeah, with that Spectre Horn down, they should actually have it. I don't think PoF wants to engage without that.
It's still Roche, though. There's still the Roche pit. There is a very high chance that they could get a whole team chronoed if they all decide to try and take this Roche. So, yeah, even though there's no Haunt, you still have to respect it.
Get the dagger out. There's available Discord. And Mario, that's not the way to go. Now, instant turnaround. There's the Chronosphere only on Minesk Fangay, as well as way too, actually. Now, as for Prism, we'll actually keep the Queen of Pain alive, and then the hammer is being dropped. Popeye is still alive with a BKB, but he's all alone now, being hexed up as a dance. He will get Sunbee. Well, that's about all. I guess she also gets the Queen of Pain somehow, but hey, that was still not worth it. That was not the fight
that
he wanted to take.
That was not the chrono. That was not the chrono that the Void wanted, but there were too many of his allies that was in the him to get the proper chrono. If he did, the problem with the Faceless Void this game is that you only have the Razor that's going to be able to capitalize it in terms of right click, and Freedom have both an OD and a Queen of Pain. So if there's any POF heroes in there, they will gladly kill those heroes because they're in the Chronosphere. So this is the problem with the Faceless Void this game. He has to second guess his Chronos if there are allies nearby.
Exactly. Especially with Sunbee. He was outside and he even saved Queen of Pain inside. With the Yes from Prism and just negating the entire effect of POF's chrono. And also worth remembering that it all started with the pick of a Disruptor here, just with a bad pathing around inside the river. He couldn't get a Static Storm off either, so they can't use their combo. Obviously, their teamfight is gonna be much, much weaker. And this is where Freedom Swans and B every single time, just being able to right-click. We talked about it again and again on the OD. All you right-click, scarier you get.
And now, the game's gonna get increasingly harder because the Omni Knight almost has his Aghanim Scepter. And obviously once you have that up, Global Guardian Angel. And because PoF is so reliant on a lot of their physical damage to make up for the fact they don't do that much, this Guardian Angel is going to make their lives almost impossible when it comes to ganks. Like, chances are the Guardian Angel might buy enough time for freedom to reinforce if someone's in trouble. And that's very problematic considering the kind of draft that they're running. They just want to go for quick chrono pickoffs, and that's it. If you can't kill them in the chrono, then you're going to be in a lot of trouble because your main counter initiation spell is used aggressively and didn't net you that kill right off the bat.
That being said though, Popeye, ahead in terms of net worth compared to everyone else on this game, and also kind of ahead of the Guardian Angel threat. It's the Global Guardian Angel threat. He does have the Refusal Blade now at the ready. I would expect Sneaking to pick it up first, but of course he's been kind of shut down a little bit. Wants to go into the casual clothes, just keep himself alive, and hasn't had much item progression since. Yeah, that Refusal Blade will at least make sure that Razor can make his damage count, but at the same time, that's mostly single target. And they still need to rely on good chronos for that to work out.
Yeah, the game's not out of the bad care of a PoF though. Just keep drawing the game out so that the Spectre keeps getting items and just slow Freedom down. Because there's also an issue for Freedom here is that even though PoF might be in a bit of a situation where they're going to be held up in their base eventually, their high ground push still isn't the best. So there is a window opportunity for PoF to get a very good high ground team fight. Just off the fact that, you know, high ground is much easier for PoF to execute from rather than on an equal terrain field where, you know, everyone's at a similar disadvantage. No, it's like maybe a disadvantage, just in a similar playing field with everybody. Yeah. So high ground's gonna be a huge factor.
Makes it just so much easier to land the Chronosphere because Freedom's gonna have to start funding themselves in a little bit, even if they stay behind. Can just have the Faces Voids time walking in, getting the King Chronosphere on the back, the cleanup in the front. That's something that we have to watch out for. As it stands though, it's a tier 2 going down in the top lane, and Freedom coming up as 5. PoF, they should know what's up. All huddled up too. Except for the Spectre, who can of course haunt in at any time. We'll run into
Zombie.
This is the question here. Zombie leaning charge has to repel on top of him.
Could be Popeye. If he drops, that's a lot of the damage output down the drain.
Oh, Faces Void, he scouts it out. Zombie, you can get a good Chronosphere now if you can turn it up, but this disruptor already going down. There's the Astral Imprisonment here, but there's a lot of damage going over to the Razor. Chronosphere now, also Ike's Mike, Guardian Angel already came out, but now there's a Shield Blade on Zombie. Can they bring him? Doesn't take any damage, Faces Void from us so far. Sneaking, he will fall, and now it's all on MJW. It's all on Popeye to turn it up, but they're doing it. They're doing it! OD ticked out after the False Promise, and well, with the amplified damage also from the Undying, I guess, also helping out tremendously there. And Undying, and Razor being able to soak so much damage from the Astral Imprisoned Hero there. Well, they picked up the slack even after the Spectre died. Beautiful fife and wipe, and now they're going to turn on Roche.
Yep. Yeah. Oh my goodness, Popeye was such a hero that game. Like, even though MJW didn't get the best chrono of his life, like, it was just Popeye cleaning house. Like, he is hitting like a truck right now. And because he's got the Diffusal Blade as well, IX Mike isn't going to be too much of a factor for the Razor. Like, whoever he's targeting, you're obviously going to be throwing that Diffusal Blade out. So, the game from Freedom, like, even though they're in a really good spot as a team, they can't afford to lose major team fights like that. And it wasn't, like, based on the fact that they had a really bad initiation or they get jumped on by POF. I think it's just because they underestimate some of the damage output coming up from POF as well. They need to respect the Razor.
Yep.
And I think it's coming to the point where they're going to have to start focusing down Popeye first because they've been sort of leaving him for last rather than taking him down first because they're always thinking, oh, we have to kill the Void or we have to stop him from Chronosphering. Oh, we have to kill the Spectre, otherwise she's going to get gold from these fights.
Yep.
And they just sort of leave the Razor last, and then he's just like, oh, great, they're going to focus me last. Let's clean house.
Yeah.
So,
it feels like it's very rare to see a Razor in that kind of position, but for me at least. But yeah, he's making it work. He's on top of the net worth chart, and it shows, right? He's very hard to bring down. Even if they wanted to focus him, even if he didn't have the Aegis, it would be, you have to chew through 20 armor at this point, as well as more than 2,200 health points, which is not easy. For freedom, because there's also the BKB, so all that magical burst, all the orb damage from the Artful Devourer even, which is a big amount of your right-click damage output, if you think about it, is not going to be there reliably for a couple of seconds at the very least, so... Yeah. That's, once again, makes it a little bit harder for freedom. And a little bit easier for POF to make sure to get something out of these fights.
Yeah.
I want to say something else, but I forgot about it. Oh yeah, the Fusil Blade for Spectre now, but... As Razor, he had to... Oh god, there's another fight, perhaps, is there? Oh, they find fun! Oh god, yeah, sneaking. Easy kill with the Mantle Star, but... Yeah, the Fusil Blade for him, and... The Fusil Blade down 4 charges on the Razor, that's what I wanted to point out. He used 4 charges in that one fight, but... Obviously worth it, and obviously he can still upgrade it.
Yeah.
To get the charges back,
absolutely. So. Honestly, you can probably just buy a fresh one.
After this defusal blade.
Look,
paid off
so much.
Oh, sneaking, they find him.
Oh, sneaking.
No Mantis style available here, now dropping the hammer, just make absolutely sure there's no way for him to go. They get a trade out of it, tier 2, yeah. Way 2 if you want, so you can probably bring that down. Try to push it out just with the tombstone here.
God, I think a big problem here for Freedom now is that we saw the 2 BKBs. I think that's probably another issue that we should address, or at least Freedom needs to address, the 2 BKBs on POF, one on Void as well as the Razor. So once those are up, you can't rely on the OD to be the only physical damage dealer.
What else do you have, though?
For those heroes.
What else do you have?
Well, I guess, to, like, you can... Like, Queen of Pain, to a certain degree, like, she's still mostly magical-based, because she's also got... Because she also picked up the Orc and Malevolence, she doesn't have the consistent uptime on her ultimate. If we replace this Orchid with an Aghanim Scepter this game, then if the fights are long drawn out, then she can actually get the double Sonic Waves, and maybe that changes the fights a little bit. Not completely, but at least they'd have a solid source of pure damage that goes through that BKB, because outside of Queen of Pain and OD... They've only got defensive supports, and they've only got Azus.
Limits back on Ike's mic, the silence from the Static Storm. Well, False Promise comes out, though. So he might not actually end up dying. This Ezreal Prism and Chronosphere committed, just to make absolutely sure they get this kill. False Promise ends, but don't have anything else. Can't throw anything else out. Maneski, they don't have the initiation angle themselves, but now they're going to be in a very good position to just start pushing out, because the Chronosphere is down for another 100 seconds, give or take. Now, there's a Assault Cuirass for Razor, though. He's got so much go, and that's countering out the one from the Queen of Pain. Also, one thing I want to point out.
Tanky.
Also, one thing I want to point out, the Moonshot on the OD. I mean, we've been talking about him not being able to do damage through the BKB, but outside of that, he's hitting for so much and so fast. I mean, supports like the Disruptor are just gonna be 2 or 3 shot at this point.
I also like the Rune Shard in this game because it's always Freedom being the aggressors. Like, they're always looking for the fights. And especially during nighttime, normally teams don't want to look for fights because their vision is hampered. Rune Shard completely mitigates nighttime. Like, you get the extra nighttime vision, which helps you with the initiation department. Like, POF is not going to see them coming. If Sunbee's first, Freedom is going to be the ones to see POF first. And that's how they've been, you know, that's been their... way of trying to get those fights in. You see them first, you initiate first. Unfortunately, they don't have their own Faceless Void. Like, if they had a Magnus, a Void, any hero with a major ultimate, even an Enigma, like, I think it would be even better for Freedom, but because they've got the heroes that they have, like, they can't pick and choose their fights. If they find one, they've got to commit.
Yep. Getting more and more to the point where you can call it late game Dota, where it all comes down to teamfight execution, because everyone has the core items up and running. Everyone has their level 11 at least, level 16 on the way too. Nothing about the Phases Boy level 16. Almost has it actually. That adds another half a second to the Chronosphere.
BKB almost done on snaking as well. So essentially all the cores on POF are soon going to be immune to the arcane orb coming out from OD.
Faceless Void is less than 50% of win rate after 40 minutes. Okay, interesting. But yeah, that's comes back to what we're talking about. They do have the late game heroes, but I would have actually expected to face the Void to be one of them.
So we've got a lot of defensive items picked up on POF. So after this, I assume POF is going to start picking up their scaling damage items. Like, Razor already has. What would you consider the Faceless Void to pick up? Is he still going to be this utility-ish sort of offlane Faceless Void, or can you start seeing him to maybe scale and pick up perhaps a Sand and Yasha for himself?
Sand and Yasha, I feel like it's too late for that. So if you want to have an extra impact in terms of damage, which I do think he should go for eventually, just make sure that even if he gets a less than ideal chrono when it comes to the positioning, that he can still do the damage. So maybe go for something like one of these the Mask of Madness. Make sure they have some extra attack speed, or just go for a Maelstrom, Jolnir, that kind of thing, right?
Yeah, that works out too.
Just add more damage in one way or extra another, even extra... even a crit, anything, right? Any sort of damage item.
I'd say maybe a bit more attack speed, then you get the chance for getting those time locks.
Yeah.
I think we also haven't really spoken about the time locks as well. Like, if you can get a time lock, that's huge.
Yep.
That's one point where a hero is not just disabled. I don't know if this was the right interaction. Does time lock also pause cooldowns? Like time dilation? I don't think it does, right?
Don't think so, no.
I don't know why. I've heard from somewhere that it actually pauses cooldowns. I'm pretty sure it was just the time dilation that did that. Because if time lock does it too, it'd be pretty broken.
A little time dilation,
Just
what I want to say. Yeah, the other option, which I think is the one that is going for, just judging by the point boost, is the Aghanim Scepter. That adds another second to the duration at level 3. And I believe puts the cooldown down to a minute. So that would be
super
useful to have, yeah. So, yeah, that's all things considered, that's the better way to go. Because they rely on the scrolls here, rely on these ultimates to get them the control for the team fights. We've talked about that before. He's still quite a ways away from it, though, unfortunately.
Yeah. So 2 minutes and 10 seconds till the next Roche, unfortunately. So Freedom, they just checked it, but it's not up. They're gonna have to wait for it. I mean, a waiting game for both teams is we sort of run into a situation like last game where both teams don't really want to fight each other anymore. They're grouping up mostly. Freedom, they're in a group of 3 and 2, whereas for POF, they are mostly together, aside from the Spectre who can go separately. But yeah, they're not actively looking for fights, they're trying to finish up their items. But I presume that once Faceless Void has finished up the Chrono, they will be actively looking for the fights with the Chronosphere.
Yep. Now, as I said, they're just trying to stay safe. They're perfectly understandable, considering that this is the last hurrah for both of these teams. Lose this game, you're not going to play in WePlay, and it's a decently sized prize pool at the end of it all.
Oh, smoke.
Oh, there it is. BKB onto MJW. Stun Chronosphere available, and now Sun passes on. BKB to Magdrono! And a Static Link already going. So much damage being thrown out, but fun. And on the outside there with the False Promise. And now the Guardian Angel perhaps turn around. Three heroes down, though, as he pops out. In fact, Diffuse Blade onto Ike's Mike. Still doesn't ram them, but there's just too much right click damage here. Coming out from the Spectre, joining in the fight, the Guru gets a Static Storm on Menesi Fangi, ultra kill for the Spectre, and it's a full 5-man wipe. Two heroes with buyback, none of them consequential, so that's gonna be a tier 2 tower, and most likely a set of racks just like that. This was the team fight that POF was waiting for, catching Freedom on the back foot with a Static Link, full duration, perfect Chronosphere. Oh man, that was Craigasm.
This is when Craigasm. Freedom says goodbye to their advantage through the entire game. Like, you take a look at the net worth as well as EXP, it was in favor of Freedom up until, like, there was another team fight before this, but it went up again. Sorry, down again. And then
so
it's
disastrous.
Gone back towards equalized.
Just,
it's terrible.
Dimensions have to say goodbye to their WePlay dreams.
It looks like it.
This is a full set of racks. 35 seconds still down on the Queen of Pain, 20 seconds on the OD, they just can't take these fights. Look at fun! This has a false promise themselves just to stay alive, to just sneaking here. Now, BKB just used on MJW just to try and secure the damage on the main Raxa. Don't have enough to quite bring it down, so there's still a sliver of hope left for Freedom, but Looking at the graphs now as they finally updated, that is such a huge spike. More than a 10k, probably close to 15k gold swing after all of that.
Same pressure kind of on experience. He's gonna go for double ult. But the biggest winner of that team fight was MJW. He was gonna be the one to be initiated on by Freedom. He insta-pops BKB, and to get a two-man chrono on both OD and the Omni Knight, and in particular IX Mike didn't get to pop the Guardian Angel till after the chrono, like, that was huge. That was what set up the fight for POF. So props to Faceless Boy, like, he technically won them that team fight just because he isolated the two core heroes on Freedom.
Now Haunt comes in, they see that the Roche is happening, and now Spectre is on the back dealing with Kiko here. Another secondary Haunt, we'll make sure that he's ghost down. Meanwhile, Sunbeam and Nesky Fangator trying to run up, Shield Wave is there, BKB comes out, Sonic Wave not doing anything, and MJW just doesn't care at this point. Chrono Spears' own teammates just take care of the targets themselves. Still sneaking though with a double kill. And that is GG, well played. Freedom, they fall 2-1. The power of friendship, they're making friendship great again. This particular matchup. Congrats to them, they will replace Complexity in WePlay League Season 3 going forward. What a series, what a match 3. I'm super happy.
Yeah, that was a great way to finish the series as well. So congratulations to Power Friendship, they're going to be replacing Complexity in WePlay. So what's happening with WePlay? Have all the teams already confirmed their slots for the tournament?
Well, tournament has been going on for 2 weeks already, more or less. There's, I think, eight teams.
I don't quite know the format.
Yeah, there's four qualifier groups, eight teams in each group. So there's one for CIS, one for the rest of the EU, SEA, and then the Americas. And they're going to play each other in a double best of one round robin format. So each team is playing each other twice. And the top people in the group gets to the finals. That's how I understand it anyway, but... Yeah, more Dota to be coming up in the WePlay over the following couple of weeks. Of course, head on over to joindota.com on the coverage page there to find the most up-to-date schedule. It's a little bit of a mess at times, a lot of games being postponed and all, but on the site you will find the most most current schedule, as current as we can make them. But yeah, for today, that marks the end of our WePlay edition. A little bit of a special playing series here between these two teams. For the WePlay League Season 3. My name is Dragon Drop. It was a great pleasure to be able to cast a series for you. Danley, my co-caster, joining me. Danley, where can they find you?
You can just probably give me a follow on my Twitter page, at DanleyCasts. That's pretty much it. Like, if you want all my other social media stuff, you'll find it there.
Go ahead
but
and do
I'm
that.
I'm mostly active on Twitter.
Go ahead and do that. And while you're at it, if you enjoyed my casting, you can also follow me at DragonDropDota. And do not forget to follow our stats lady, at LurkerDerp, was responsible for the stats pop-ups throughout the series. Yeah, that's about all the shameless plugs that we have, so all that's left to say is thank you very much for watching, and see you next time.
GG.